In this video, I want to address threats to creativity in the negotiation process or in the planning process. Okay, so in prior videos, we discussed the role of creativity and how creativity contributes to the formation of strategies and the implementation of tactics. With that being said, there are numerous threats or traditionally psychological tendencies that cause issues with being creative in a negotiation. So these are considered threats to the ability to be creative in a negotiation. So I want to identify some of these more common threats to creativity in the negotiation process. The first, inert knowledge. That is your inability to recall information at a given time, in a given situation, particularly in the ability to use that information in a given context. So the inability to make use of knowledge or information that you have. All right, so inert knowledge. The knowledge doesn't move within you, okay? The next one is transfer, or problems with transfer. So surface level transfer is the ability to take similar situations and apply the characteristics of to surface level or only cursory similarities exist, right? And you apply the lessons learned or tactics or whatever you take from one scenario to another, right? Deep level is when you think more deeply on it and you take the underlying principles or ingrained processes and apply it to another situation, right? So once again, having problems with the ability of knowledge transfer to relate common or related situations or approaches used in different situations to the resolution of a negotiation. All right. Next is availability heuristic. It's a bias. It's basically how prior experience, knowledge, exposure affects us and our tendency to believe something or to use prior approaches, for example, because that's what we've been exposed to. That's the most common thing that we've seen. That's the most common thing that we know. All right, so relying on more of what we've seen rather than objectively looking at all the opportunities, right? Representativeness, that is making assumptions about the situation or other people or scenarios. It's a specific form of it is stereotyping, right, where you assume something is going to happen or a course of action will pursue or certain characteristics exist just because of the surface level characteristics of someone or the situation, right? So you think one situation is representative of how all similar types of situations will go, and that's generally not the case, right? So it causes you to keep things narrow and in a box rather than thinking creatively about things that could happen, right? Things, ways you could go in a particular negotiation. All right. Base rate and gambler's fallacy. So the base rate fallacy is when you take a specific instance, like an anecdotal scenario that you noticed or a single study or something like that, and assume that that is right, where there is lots of other information. You ignore the wealth of information for one data point or one source of information, right? So you're using that base rate rather than the wealth or collection of all information out there to be used, okay? Gambler's fallacy is related to that because, you know, it's in statistics, we say, you know, over time, things regress back to the mean or the average, right? Well, the gambler's fallacy believes that in any given scenario, because a certain thing will happen more times than not, like there's a 60% chance something will happen, right? And because something hasn't happened before, the gambler believes, well, it's definitely going to happen this time. Well, in that scenario, all actual occurrences are independent. So the likelihood of it occurring over the long run does not affect, right? Does not imply that in this given scenario that will be the case, right? Because every individual instance is independent, right? So that being said, it's a false belief in how statistical averages apply to a given independent scenario, okay? Unwarranted causation, and that simply believes that you believe that one situation, scenario, or characteristic is the cause of a given outcome, right? Where oftentimes it's the combination of any you know, given context or scenario that causes an outcome, right? So attributing some level of causation wrongfully, right, can cause you to think, oh, well, this cause will always result in this outcome, right? This input will always result in this output. Well, that's not the case always, right? Because you're wrongfully attributing that causation. You don't think outside the box more broadly. Okay, belief perseverance, that is where you double down and continue to believe something even after it's been proven wrong or incorrect. Okay, that is a very common tendency among people. We call it being hard-headed or whatever, just irrational escalation type scenario. But once again, you continue to believe something, once again, even though it's been shown not to be true. Okay, illusory correlation. Correlation is when one thing changes, the other thing changes, and they change in concert together with some regular pattern, right? Okay, so if one goes up, the other one goes down, or they both go up together in similar measurable amounts. Oftentimes people assume there's causation in correlation, and they're completely two different things, right? So you start to believe that either because something is correlated that it's the cause, or that sometimes things are correlated when they're actually not, right? These are just specific incidences that something else are causing the two things to relate, not the underlying aspect or characteristic of it that you say are correlating or are correlated, okay? Defensive attributions, right? This is when you tend to attribute specific aspects of something, as the name implies, to defend the position, right? To make it seem as if it's correct or right, in order to maintain your belief in something, when ultimately that's not true, okay? When you want to guard a position or guard a point of view, right? And so, once again, we call that defensive attributions. And the reason that can thwart creativity is, once again, because you're, rather than looking at things objectively, it's a very subjective point of view, and you start looking outside the box there. Okay, blaming the victim attributions, as that name applies, something goes wrong, you say, whatever was negatively affected, that's the problem, rather than the process. Rather than all the causal factors associated with it. Okay, hindsight bias, that's the Monday morning quarterbacking, the belief that, you know, something is predictable after you see the result, like that the early on that result should have been predictable, right? That it would have been easier to see, right? When really it wouldn't have, right? You couldn't have seen that outcome from the information you had before, the process, right? So again, that hindsight bias, a similar thing is creeping determinism, which makes you believe that something is the natural result of a series or process when it's not, right? It happened to result in that scenario, in that series of a course of action, but that's not always the case, right? It's that's not the natural result there, okay? Functional fixedness. Again, this is focusing on the results of a particular process, right? That this is the set effect that you're going to have from a given course of action or process. Selective attention, that means paying attention, one, to things that, one, are more obvious, or two, align with what you're already thinking or what is more convenient to you, rather than looking broadly. And lastly, overconfidence, right? Looking, not accepting outside information because you're overly confident about your ability to affect the outcome or the process in the situation. Okay, so all of these taken together are major threats to creativity, because collectively they all have the effect of causing you not to consider other options, right? Not to look outside of some level of expectation that you have for how cause and effect, are related to each other in the scenario. So that being said, if you can identify these, if you can recognize these, right? Then you can mitigate their impact upon the creative process in a negotiation.